It's funny how supersessionists will grab on to the blessings. For I know the plans that I have for you. Yeah. But they don't take the judgments. They say that the blessings are for the church, the judgments are for Israel. They were Christ killers. And so because they killed Christ, that was the ultimate rejection. Therefore, we need to reject the people too. Where does the Bible come into all this?
If God is done with Israel, then you have a problem with Revelation. They're getting ready to pour out judgment, and God says, well, hold off until my people are sealed. Who are the people? If God was done with Israel, then why would they still be here?
The Mike Charleston Show.
All right. Yes. 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 This is the Mike Charleston Show. Thank you for watching. We are all together. I don't think were we last week? You were gone.
I was gone.
Yeah, you were gone.
Maybe. Was I last week?
No, you were here last week.
You were here.
Yeah. Okay. It was the week before.
Are we here today?
Or 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, next week we're not going to be all together.
Right.
But anyway, if you have not noticed, though, there's been something in the news lately, and I don't really pay attention to the news. We don't get involved in news and politics. That's why we had to change the show opener where we talked about church, family, news. I'm like, we don't do news. Yeah, we don't use it.
I don't think it means what you think it means.
Israel has been in the news a lot lately. Yeah. And so I thought, man, we've got to talk about this on some level, but what angle are we going to, how are we going to talk about? So Chuck, what are we talking about today?
Well, the question you got here is God done with Israel?
Is God done with Israel? I wanted to talk about prophecy, like how do you make a show about like that? And so is God done? And so when you talk about this issue in theology, they have come up with words.
Oh, yeah.
And Larry likes to use these big words. So what's the big word?
Suppressionism or supersessionalism.
Wow, I gave you
your one. I know, I feel it. I'm thinking of all these other ones. I was going to say replacement theology, and I'm like, that's not the big
supersessionism.
One. Supersessionism.
Supersessionism.
You should probably stick with replacement theology.
Yeah, the big word.
You caught me off guard.
Supersessionism is the big word. Known basically as replacement theology. Now, there is a lot of different views on within supersessionism and theology and replacement theology. So we're not going to get into all of it, but basically, what is supersessionism?
Basically, the church replaced Israel.
Okay, yeah, I mean, I was going to, maybe you're going to read that part right there.
Sorry. I guess I could have read it, but
supersessionism.
Or the church superseded Israel and now has become the Israel of God.
Right, right. That's a very basic understanding. But yeah, it's that the replacement theology or fulfillment theology or even covenant theology or whatever is a Christian theological doctrine which describes the theological conviction, a lot of theological conviction, that the Christian church has superseded the nation of Israel, assuming their role as God's covenanted people, thus asserting that the new covenant through Jesus Christ has superseded or replaced the Mosaic covenant exclusive to the Jews. And we'll get into where this came from, but all the promises are now the church's. It's no longer Israel.
Yeah, what's that song? All the promises of Abraham are mine? You don't remember that in Sunday school?
No.
Oh. No.
Father Abraham?
No.
No, I remember that one.
Larry, anyway. You know a song we don't know. How about
apparently.
This?
Apparently.
Yeah, this is breaking news.
You'll have to sing it for us later.
Yes, please do. So that is a very broad definition of supersessionism or replacement theology, but that is at the heart of it, that all the promises, all the things that we take from the Old Testament, that the church is replaced Israel.
Replaced Israel.
And that to the point where people like Luther, and even like, we'll get into it here, the early church fathers, that not only has God rejected them, he has cursed them, and it is our right to punish Israel for it, which is bizarre as some of the things that were said. Anti-Semitism was alive and well in the first century.
Yeah.
And probably always has been.
Probably so. So where does this idea of replacement theology, where did it originate?
So that's a good question, right? Like, okay, so why does this come about and how? So here's the danger of taking the scriptures and what I believe happened. Now, I could be wrong. I'm speculating here. But people saw the news of the day and they're trying to fit things in with the news of the day. So around the first century, you got to remember when a lot of these people, the temple was destroyed in 70 AD. Israel is gone at this point.
And as a nation, they're wiped out.
Yeah, at 135 or something like that. By 135, they're gone. Yeah. They're
dispersed.
They are dispersed. It's under Roman control, right. Yeah. And so Israel is no longer a nation. So if you're a reading the Bible, if you're a Christian, you're wondering like, well, maybe God is done with Israel. They're no longer a country, and so we are becoming more and more. The church is becoming more and more Gentile. So maybe it's for us. So one of the first people to talk about this, and we don't have some of the quotes from their writings and things like that, but you can look it up. It's just trust us on this. But Justin Martyr, he was around, and that's an interesting last name. I don't know.
Yes, it is.
Yeah, Justin Martyr.
I thought that too.
So good old Justin, he was around from 100 to 165 AD. He claimed Christians are the true Israelic race. The seed of Jacob refers to Christians, not the Jews. So the problem with replacement theology is it really challenges your hermeneutics. Larry, here's another big word, hermeneutics.
Or dispensationalism.
Okay, but that's another term, but that's a part of hermeneutics.
Right.
But so hermeneutics is what?
Method of studying the Bible.
How you study the Bible, right? Yeah. So you can spiritualize things, you can allegorize things, or you can kind of take things literally. And when we talk about literal, it's not just you take it like Jesus is the door. You understand within the context of language that there are similes, there are metaphors, and so on and so forth.
You realize that Jesus spoke in parables.
Yes, right. But we don't go back and spiritualize some of the prophecies. We don't have to say that Jacob and Esau, that when it says the older will serve the younger, that you turn and say, well, Israel is Jacob, I mean, not Jacob, Esau, and now the church is Jacob, which Jacob has never, ever been associated anything but with Israel.
Right.
His name became Israel,
that's right.
So then we move on to Tertullian, and Tertullian was around 145 to 220. He's the one that came up with the Jacob-Esau concept, the older and will serve the younger, which is I'm like, come on, man. That's not a very good argument.
That's a stretch.
It's just symbolic.
It is. Yeah, it's an allegory, and we're going to run with it. And it
Which,
works.
By the way, who changed Jacob's name?
God did.
Yeah, it wasn't Jacob. He didn't pick that. God did.
No. Yeah, so. God changed it to Israel.
Yeah.
And Tertullian also, since the Jews were originally the people of God, they are the older ones. We just kind of talked about this, and the Gentiles are Jacob and so on and so forth. Then we go into Origen, and Origen has a shady past here, and
He was a Gnostic, if I remember correctly.
Okay, yeah, and he's from 185 to 253 AD. So this is building. And this is still the church that is persecuted, and they're not officially. You know, the Constantine has not come in and stepped foot on the. He hasn't become the empire is not the empire yet.
But I would say these teachings actually gave some credence to what he did and how he established the state church blending.
So then Origen, he was president of school of theology in Alexandria, Egypt. There's two schools of thoughts, and one was more Alexandrian, one was Antiochian. Yep. We're not going to get into that right now, but he developed the allegorical method of interpreting the Bible. So his hermeneutics, he was open about it. He was like, we have to take it allegorically, which the Catholic Church would then run with.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they ran with this. They loved Origen and all them. Israel didn't mean Israel. It was just spiritual Israel / the church. Then Augustine comes on the scene, and Augustine is the big one. The 354 to 430, he concluded that there will not be a literal thousand-year reign. So he came up with the amillennial, another theological term, which meaning no or not, and millennial. So no millennial. It's not literal. It's figurative.
Yeah, figure.
You it's allegorical once again, and this became very popular, I don't know, popular, prevalent in the Catholic Church. Yeah. This is something
we are in the millennial now.
Yeah, this is very common with Catholic Church and even the most Calvinists. Not all Calvinists, but most Calvinists would believe these things. He applied allegory method to all future events, all millennialism. He taught the church is the kingdom of God in Daniel 2 and 7 and Revelation 20. The Roman church adopted this view. And anyway, so that's kind of the history of it, Chuck, since you asked the question. Yeah. that's kind of where it came from. And actually, we were reading about something else, and I didn't think about this, but it is interesting that the... how you were describing it, you read the article, not me, you know, I didn't read it, but you were telling me about it, and it kind of made sense that the early church was very family oriented. Mm-hmm. Like the method of meeting, they didn't build buildings. Yeah. They didn't have a priesthood. They didn't have any of these things that the church is associated with now.
Yeah.
And but because all these teachings, it pointed that, hey, we've replaced Israel. Guess what? We need a priesthood now. We need to do the sacrifices where the Catholic Church now does the Mass, because they have to do the sacrifices as the Jewish people did. And so all these things, because we took over, now we had to spiritualize those things and took over. And I was like, you know what? I never even thought about it, but it does make sense. So just think about that.
Right. Well, you think about it, in the Old Testament, they had a temple.
Yep.
With the altar, do the sacrifice.
They had a special priest class.
And that's when Constantine legalized Christianity, gave them what used to be pagan temples, and they now became churches, Christian churches. But also he gave them tax breaks, and if you were a pastor, you didn't have to pay taxes.
Sure.
The church blended with the state. Just like in Israel, it was a theocracy in the beginning, and then it became a monarchy. But still, the theology of Israel, it was part ruling. The priests were part rulers of the nation,
right?
And in combination with the king. But then as Christianity in the 300s, that's when they kind of took these ideas from the earlier church fathers, blended them together and say, hey, yeah, we're now the Israel of God, the churches.
So this has been back from the very beginning. I mean, we're not removed too much from the scriptures even being written in 90 AD when John writes Revelation, and maybe even the book of John, but those are like the last books that we believe were written. And just one generation, we're already... saying, forgetting that Jesus was Jewish, the disciples were all Jewish, that the first Christians, all 3,000 of them were Jewish. The majority of the Christian church was Jewish, and at some point they separated it. It got so anti-Semitic that, in fact, we've covered this before on the Easter show, the pagan holiday Easter, that the when they redid the calendar, the Catholic Church made it so that we will never celebrate the resurrection of Christ on the actual day that he raised.
Yeah.
If you want to know when Jesus raised from the dead, it's not that hard. It's in the Bible.
Yeah,
it's in the Bible. When the big Passover was. It was right then and there. You don't have to figure out, go look at the Jewish calendar. But we don't want to do that because we don't want anything to do with Jews. And let me just say this. Like, we're not like super lovers of Jews, you know, like we need to go back and be Jewish and keep the law. And if you've watched the show, you should know that by now.
You're not going to put on your yarmulke?
No, not going to do all that. But the argument that we're portraying here is like, is God done with Israel?
Right.
That's the question. And obviously we're in the church age, and we are grafted into these things, and I know people that believe in supersessionism, they're going to say that Israel can be saved, like they can become believers, but that's about all that God, all the future plans that God has for them is done away with. Like he is not going to have anything to do with them anymore. So anyway,
so it's interesting to me. I've never really studied replacement theology or supersessionism, which supersessionism, I've never heard of before today. But it's interesting that you mentioned that, you know, given the time frame when this came about, there was no nation of Israel. You had the Jewish people. They were scattered. And so it's interesting to think that maybe these folks were trying to fit it into their current position. And I think that's a caution for us to actually make sure we're not approaching God's word and trying to make it fit into what we experience.
Right. No, I think that's very natural that they would probably look around like, well, my goodness, God abandoned them. I mean, but some of the things they said are very brutal. I mean, Luther was such an anti-Semite. And to read some of the things that he said, he believed that the Jews should be exterminated. Yeah. And it's no wonder that just a few generations later, they did exactly what Luther was saying, that they should be put in their own little towns and things called ghettos, you know, and put in their little neighborhoods, and they should be exterminated and all these things and punished. And he didn't say it like I just said it, but
he did say to burn synagogues and like their places of worship and whatever. So I mean, and I don't know. Hitler calls him our great national hero. Luther.
Yeah.
So, let's get into a little bit more. The question here is, what's wrong? What's wrong with believing replacement theology like Luther did?
Yeah, and before we tackle that question, we have to mention that, you know, we said the Catholics are very much into this, you know, the amillennialism, and they are replacement theology, they're supersessionism. And same thing with Calvinists, a lot of Calvinists are. But to be fair, there's the new churches that are springing up, the big churches that are out there, the non-denominational churches, the what we would call part of the NAR, the New Apostolic Reformation. A lot of charismatic churches, I shouldn't say a lot of them, because the church I grew up in was a charismatic church, and they definitely did not believe this. But a lot of the newer churches fall into this. We'll talk about that later here. But what's wrong with believing in replacement theology? And to be fair, there can be genuine believers that believe this. We're not trying to say that they're not saved if you believe this. You know, smart people have been studying these things for centuries. But what is wrong with believing in replacement theology? Well, what about the blessings for the church, but not the judgments? Now, this is a very oversimplistic argument.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying by that is, you have prophecies, you have promises in the Old Testament. It's funny how the supersessionists will grab on to the blessings.
Yeah, okay.
For I know the plans that I have for you, and Jeremiah 29:11. But they don't take the judgments. They say that the blessings are for the church, the judgments are for Israel.
Yeah.
Well, that's convenient.
You can't separate them. They both came together. Right. Yeah, I mean, Well, the other thing, like you mentioned prophecy, when the angel came to Daniel and he said, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people. Well, who was Daniel's people?
That's the next point.
So
it major changes in eschatology.
Yeah.
So you have to change your belief about end time stuff. And you might say, okay, well, I don't know what I believe about end times. Does it really matter? Well, it does.
Yeah, it does.
It really does in some ways. Now, at the end of the day, like if you were a post-trib or mid-trib or pre-trib, it doesn't matter when he comes back. But if you're an amillennialist, sure does.
Yeah, preterist
even. Yeah, that's that just sounds bad. Yeah. But your major changes in eschatology. So the old Israel had a priesthood, so God wants us to be the new church to have a priesthood. Well, you're going to have... Wait, no, that's ecclesiology.
Yeah, and okay. We already talked about that.
Well, God made a covenant with Abraham that he would have descendants, you know, like the sand of the sea, stars of the heavens.
Right.
But then he also reiterated in a way that covenant with David, saying that you will always have a descendant on the throne. That's not a throne in heaven. That was actually the throne in Israel, in Jerusalem.
Right.
That's what he's talking about.
Yeah. A lot of these promises are going to have to be spiritualized.
Right.
Somehow.
And that's where you go back to origin and the allegorizing everything.
Right.
And,
but he would also say that the Mosaic covenant that God made with Abraham was replaced by the new covenant in Jesus Christ.
Right.
Well, that's a good point. But then you have some issues with
Like we talked about in the Sabbath, like the on the Sabbath episode that we did here recently, that the Mosaic covenant was for a certain time.
Right.
Abrahamic covenant was everlasting. Yeah. Davidic covenant was everlasting. So we have to understand these things. And this is where hermeneutics come in. So ecclesiology, which I meant to say not eschatology, yeah. but even though it does change your eschatology too.
Yeah.
And if you're an amillennialist or a preterist or something, it does change how you study the Bible. I can tell how you study the Bible, how you take the Bible based on your eschatology.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
If you don't, if you're a millennialist, I know that you pretty much allegorize a lot of the scriptures. Everything's an allegory. If you take things pretty literally, you're going to be some kind of pre-trib, mid-trib, post-trib type of person. The closer you get to post-trib, a little bit more spiritual in that. But the effects on replacement theology on the Jews. So. The persecution of Jewish people by the Roman Church started early and often. I mean, they crushed them.
Yeah.
But even people like Martin Luther, and we got into this a little bit, but the specific things, he told people to burn down synagogues, helped lay the foundation of the Holocaust. Hitler called Luther our great national hero. And that's Hitler, pointing out some of the things that Luther had taught. You know, with some of these people, we didn't go into some of the quotes that the early church fathers had or even Hitler, but some of them, I'm not going to quote them exactly, so I guess it won't be a quote. I'll just paraphrase.
Yeah.
But they were saying things like they were Christ killers. And so because they killed Christ, that was the ultimate rejection. Therefore, we need to reject the people too. Well, I where does the Bible come into all this? This is the problem I have, is that part of the Bible is love one another. Love your enemies. So even if we were to say the Israelites were enemies, we're still to love them.
Right.
We're not supposed to burn down their synagogues.
Well, technically speaking, the Jews did not kill Jesus.
No, the Romans did.
The Romans did.
Right.
Right.
I mean, they persuaded them, but the Romans still had... So
we're all guilty.
The Romans were Gentiles.
Yes, right.
So are we to hate Gentiles because they killed Christ? I mean, and then Jesus also said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
Yeah.
So...
And the church doesn't have the chance to crucify Jesus because, well, he's already been crucified and risen. Right. So I bet you we would have at some point. Yeah. But some of those reasonings are bizarre.
Yeah.
You know, they just want to find a reason to blame. If it had not been for the Jews rejecting Messiah, we wouldn't be in, as we're going to read here pretty shortly.
Right.
So we should be grateful, you know, honestly. But to go around persecuting them is a shame.
What is it Paul said? Blindness in part has happened to Israel?
Yeah.
I mean, that's what Romans, is that chapter 4, I think, or 5?
4 maybe, or 5,
somewhere
right.
around there, I think, yeah. But like you said, if the church existed at that time, the church probably would have been part of the party to crucify Christ.
Yeah, because we're all a part of this.
Yeah.
We're all guilty. My sin put him there.
Right.
So it's just because the Jews persuaded him to be crucified, and the Romans actually put the nails in him.
Yeah.
So who actually, it doesn't matter. We're all complicit in this.
So going back to our topic question, is God done with Israel? What's the Bible? Let's look at the scripture. What's the Bible got to say about it?
Yes. So the verse that automatically comes to mind, and actually it's a portion of scripture, Romans 9 through 11.
I thought you were saying this verse, but you were talking about all chapters.
Right. You can go Romans 9 through 14 almost, but it deals with a lot of these. But specifically, Romans 11, 19 through 25, we didn't know which portions to pull out of Romans 11. It's so clear in Romans 11, but maybe I haven't been talking. Why don't you go ahead and read?
Okay. Thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off, that I might be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed lest he also spare not thee. Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God, on them which fell severity, but toward thee goodness, if thou continue in his goodness. Otherwise thou also shalt be cut off.
Okay, let me stop you right there. So there's a lot of going on here. So because of their unbelief, they were broken off. So he's talking about a tree here, mm-hmm. and he's talking about how Israel had been broken off. So they're like, see, they're gone.
Yeah, right.
They were broken off. But and we were grafted in. So we were wild by nature, you know, we were contrary to the things of God, and we weren't his people. But just like Jeremiah was saying that, prophesied that in Jeremiah 33, 31, that there was going to be a time where there was a, how does it say it, where, help me out here. There's going to be a people who were not a people that were going to be a people.
Yeah.
And they would be his God, or that God would be their God.
Yeah.
And but because of this, they were that the Gentiles were becoming high minded. Like, have we replaced Israel? You know, this is kind of the background of this, that we get the blessings of all these things, and he's saying not so much here, that they were broken off, that you might be grafted in. So go ahead and continue.
And they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again.
So he can graft them in again, right. And which I think he will.
Yeah.
For if thou wert cut out of the olive tree, which is wild by nature, and wert grafted contrary to nature into a good olive tree, how much more shall these, which shall be the natural branches, be grafted into their own olive tree? For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in.
There's that verse.
Yeah, there you go. There read on, right?
Yeah.
The fullness of the Gentiles must happen. This must come apart. You know, there's other prophecies in the Old Testament that needed to be fulfilled. And Ezekiel 34, I believe, or the one in Jeremiah, that's the one. There it is, 31. I guess we can go right there. Jeremiah 31, 35 through 36.
It says, thus saith the Lord, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinances of the moon and of the stars for a light by night, which divideth the sea when the waves thereof roar. The Lord of hosts is his name. If those ordinances depart from before me, saith the Lord, then the seed of Israel also shall cease from being a nation before me forever.
Right. So basically saying that the sun rises, the stars are out, the moon and all that. And when they go away, then Israel will go away.
So it's God's by. Israel never stopped being a nation.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And in fact, do you have the Acts 1? Yeah, Acts 1, 6 through 7.
When they therefore were come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power.
So this is after he's risen. Mm-hmm. So they've been expecting Jesus to come to power and to crush the Romans, and it didn't work out the way they thought. In fact, it worked out better. You know, wow, he's conquered death and sin, and like, wow, we're now free. And so, but they still believed in the promises.
They were looking for that kingdom still.
Right, yeah. And rightly so.
Yep.
And because of all the promises.
Yep.
And so they're like, Jesus never corrected them and said, no, you guys still don't get it. It's not about this. The kingdom is already here. It's a spiritual kingdom. And, you know, you'll find out when the comforter comes and all that. And in fact, he doesn't correct them at all. He says it's just not time.
Yeah.
It's not time.
And a good point is, I mentioned at the beginning, the word dispensationalism. If you don't have a correct dispensation view of the Bible, you're going to be off on your theology. At the end of Romans 11, you mentioned, it says the fullness, until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. That means there's a time period for the Gentiles.
Sure.
Right.
So there's a time period for these things that God hasn't. Sometimes those time periods are long, sometimes they're short, but
yeah,
we have to understand those dispensations.
There can be problems with dispensationalism.
Right.
You know, you may not like everything that goes along with it, but to go the other way with covenant theology, there's huge problems over there. But there has to be some kind of dispensation where God deals with people differently.
Yeah, we have the Old and New Testament.
There's different covenants. Before I went, I'm going to go to Genesis 17:7 up here, and why don't you go ahead and read that.
And I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed after thee in their generations for an everlasting covenant to be a God unto thee and to thy seed after thee.
He's talking to Abraham there, right. And these are everlasting covenants. Psalm 105:8-11.
He hath remembered his covenant forever, the word which he commanded to 1,000 generations, which covenant he made with Abraham, and his oath unto Isaac, and confirmed the same unto Jacob for a law, and to Israel for an everlasting covenant, saying, unto thee will I give the land of Canaan, the lot of your inheritance.
So that is an inheritance. That is not a promise for us.
Right.
The church. Yeah. We don't inherit Israel, the land of Canaan. That is not for us. And that the problem is when we go to the scriptures and we read the Bible like a devotional, and we we open it up and we're like, speak to me, how does this affect my life today? And like, what can I get out of this? It's very dangerous.
Yes.
And we go to Jeremiah 29:11 and say, you know, for I know the plans you have for me. And it has nothing to do with you.
Right.
It's talking about Israel being restored. If you go back and look at the context, there's a lot of judgment there. Yeah, right. And then he says, but it's only for a short time. Right. And I'm going to restore you back into your land and so on and so forth. It has nothing to do with us, even though it's true.
Right.
Right. God does have plans for us. And sure, that's fine. But we just throw these verses out. Sprinkle them out there as if they belong to us, and they don't. We have to read the Bible the way it was intended, and then we can understand things a little bit better.
Yeah, it was written for us, but not to us.
Yes, exactly. It's designed for us to understand.
Just give a cliche.
There you go. Where are we at? Hosea 3:5.
Afterward shall the children of Israel return and seek the Lord their God and David their king, and shall fear the Lord and his goodness in the latter days.
In the latter days, they shall return.
Oh, Joel's army.
Well, which I don't understand how, I can understand how, like Chuck, you were saying earlier about how because of what was happening.
Yeah.
But when 1948 happened,
exactly what I was thinking. It's like, now what am I doing?
Maybe we should rethink our ideology. Yeah, exactly. Nope, we're sticking with it. And
well, you think about it. So the Jews were dispersed, and I think it's like 586 BC, something like that, by the Babylonians. Maybe the dates are wrong.
But I thought it was much earlier than that.
No. That was for...
Are you talking about BC?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
That was for the for 70 years.
Yep.
Right, then. Right. The Medo-Persian Empire came. Cyrus became king.
Yep.
He gave the commission for them to go back to their land.
Absolutely.
And then the Romans, you know, years later, the Romans took over. The Romans actually called the land Palestine. That's where we get the word Palestine from.
Right.
To take away their national identity, they changed the name of their land. But in 70 AD, Titus, the Roman general, came in. There was a siege. They destroyed Jerusalem, dispersed the Jews again.
Yeah.
And they remained dispersed until...
1948 became a country again.
So it's the only people group in history to maintain their national identity throughout their history like that, even though they were dispersed several times.
Yeah.
Think about that. Yeah, it's...
This nothing country, like small country. We're talking about the size of New Jersey.
Yeah.
It is such a issue in world politics. If you don't believe the scriptures, I'm like, come on, man.
Yeah.
All right, Zechariah 13:8-9.
And it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, but the third shall be left therein. And I will bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people, and they shall say, the Lord is my God.
Yeah. Yeah, we have some here that some teachers, and I don't necessarily want to go through some of the teachers.
Well, a thing with, if God is done with Israel, then you have a problem with Revelation. Was it chapter 7, I think it is, 6, where the angel, they're getting ready to pour out judgment, and God says, well, hold off until my people are sealed. And who are the people?
The church?
It's 12. Yeah, it's not the church. It's 12,000 people from each of the 12 tribes of Israel.
Very specific.
Yeah.
Right.
So that's not
the church. How do you spiritualize that?
And if Israel is not here and God's done with them, then why have that in the Bible?
Right.
That doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, I believe
he's... Plus, you're Jehovah's Witness.
Well, you know, you have... You're talking about going back to Romans 11. You're going to have the cutoff. That Israel's been cut off. And yes, are they, like, active in God's plan right now? You know, probably not, like, it was salvation.
Right.
You know, the salvation that comes through grace, through faith. faith, by faith, is out there available for all, and it's not coming through the Jewish people anymore. They're not the ones propagating, you know, the message, and so they're in a state of rebellion. You know, they are rejecting God, but God has plans for His people because He's going to keep His promises to Jacob, Isaac, Abraham. He's going to keep his promises to them. And in fact, we're going to be cut off, I believe. I believe that's what the rapture is, personally. That it's a cutting off. And He's going to engraft them back in. Yeah. It's Jacob's trouble. That's what the tribulation is. And He's purifying Israel at that point. And all of Israel will be saved. That's what in Romans 11, it goes on to say that all of Israel will be saved at that point. And they will look on Him who they have pierced. And what does it say in Zechariah 10? They'll look on Him and appears and believe, or something like that. But
I have to look it up. I don't remember.
That reference that handy.
To your point, this is something that I think people need to understand. The nation of Israel is different than the church, but the people of Israel, they need to be saved the same way as a Gentile. Your salvation is only through Christ, even though you may be a Jew. And you may be a practicing Jew, but if you want to be saved, you have to come through Christ.
Right.
Just as any other Gentile or Jew, it's for everybody. It's the same. But we're talking about just specifically the nation as a whole and the nation of Israel as a whole.
Absolutely. Like the God, as a nation, God's still not done with them. No. So the things in the news that we see are quite interesting. You know, is this where some of the prophecies are talking about, where people are going to attack and God miraculously saves Israel? Is the rapture soon? Yeah, you know, I always keep my eyes on the Middle East. Yep. To me, those are important issues to pay attention to. And you found it?
I did.
In Zechariah 12:10, mm-hmm. Right. And I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplication, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness of his firstborn. I don't think that has happened.
Not yet. It's coming.
They have rejected Messiah.
Well, if God was done with Israel, then why would they still be here?
Right.
Yes. Yeah.
I mean, that's a question they're not answering.
Why are they back?
God's not capable? God's not capable.
When you think about it, how small of a country they are with all those people who hate them. Yeah. Well, my question to you, without God, why would they exist?
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And they should have been wiped off a long time ago. Yeah. But God still has a plan for them, and I think that's.
Obviously, the Jewish people are still believing the promises of God that they've had from their heritage.
Some of them,
but they're still looking forward to those promises, and someday they're going to see it and realize that it wasn't what they thought it was.
Right, and God will get them to that point.
That will get them there.
And it's a purifying that some may say is cruel, but it's a way to get them to turn to Him.
If you read the book of Judges, that's a series of... They would follow God, then they would not. They'd go after idols. God would bring judgment.
That was their history. Yes.
Yeah. And then God would send a deliverer. They would turn back to God for a time. So there will come a time where the nation of Israel will turn its eyes towards God. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it's coming.
Yeah.
Soon. But
Before we get off here real quick, we want to some of these terms. So replacement theology, supersessionism. Is taught in Kingdom Now theology. You might hear that too, Kingdom Now theology or Dominionism. You might hear some of that term, or the Latter Rain, or the New Apostolic Reformation. I know we just threw out a bunch of terms, but if you ever hear those things, be assured that they believe in supersessionism, or that Israel has been replaced by the church. And it is a dangerous teaching. Most people that are involved in this aren't anti-Semites, be fair.
Yeah.
They're not wanting the destruction of the Jews. They're just misinformed, and they don't know their Bible very well. But it can be. as we know, that some of these, if you just look up some of the early church fathers and what they said about the Jews, it's like, good night. Right. They are.
Where's the Christian love?
It is brutal. I'm like, good night.
You know, I think that when we see these people who have this theology and have this idea, it goes back to what Paul was writing in a warning, that they're thinking too high-mindedly of themselves.
Exactly.
They're thinking about me. And not necessarily that the Jews have been put away, but that I'm better.
Yeah.
Same kind of idea the Jews had against all the Gentiles. I'm better.
Yeah.
Exactly. We're all these people.
So yeah, be careful that you say that, because God still got something for them.
Yeah.
And in fact, if it wasn't for their failure, you wouldn't be grafted in. And so I'm thankful personally that they did reject Messiah, and now that's open for all of us.
Yep.
Because let's be fair, the Jews were originally supposed to be the ones to bring the message of God to the world, and they didn't do it.
Well, that's the whole point when Jesus said, "You are the light of the world." He's talking to the nation of Israel.
Right.
They were that light. They were supposed to be the light of the world. They failed.
Right.
And
So do we.
Exactly.
We fail at it too. But anyway, that, so we're trying to take a huge topic and put it in a half hour window. So I know we skipped over some important details and we didn't get into all the specifics and all the verses, but that's just a thing to get you a taste for it.
Yeah.
And go search for it yourself. Go look up supersessionism and go look at some where it started. That's interesting, because all those early church fathers and all the people of the faith that you think is so wonderful, Calvin and Luther and Huss and all them, they had some pretty harsh things to say. Not very loving things. But anyway, go check it out yourself.